2544. And if you are not, if you are unable to call, you can easily email us at leadershipwithadifference@gmail.com. So once again, leadershipwithadifference@gmail.com. So today, as I said earlier, I'm here, and the topic that I will deal with today is intelligence. What is it and who has it? So once again, intelligence, what it is and who has it. We live in a world where, as my motivational quote said, where people tend to equate intelligence with somebody who attended university, somebody with a big title behind their name, you know, a professor, an assistant professor, a lecturer, a researcher, an author, a skilled technician, you name it. People tend to categorize people in that way. And even sometimes the people who are on the technical side, sometimes they are not as rated as highly as they deserve and they should be. So the question of intelligence is important for us to have a clear understanding, clearly define it, and understand exactly what it encompasses. The psychologists themselves have been challenged in terms of providing a definition that is utterly clear, you know? Because when we think of intelligence, we will associate it with learning, memory, and cognition. Now, people in the field of psychology, as myself and others who are listening, may be easily able to associate what these terms mean. But I'm speaking here to the world, and not everyone will be involved in the field of psychology. Because when we think of learning, you know, many people may view learning merely as, you know, you're in a class, you absorb information, and you answer a question. But is that really learning, right? I mean, fundamentally, for learning to take place, there must be a change in behavior. So whatever you are exposed to in school, whatever question you may answer, if there is no change in behavior, positively I should say, you know, you really cannot speak about learning that took place, all right? Memory, as you know, well, simply ability to remember. There are a range of techniques that people use, either consciously or unconsciously. And then cognition, obviously, we're talking about thinking, your manner of gaining knowledge and using knowledge, right? So just to add a little clarity. So if we associate intelligence with those mental abilities, I just try to shed a little clarity in terms of if that's the focus or the lens through which you look at it. Now, as I said a while ago, many people are brilliant in terms of remembering stuff and answering questions. But is that a true mark of intelligence, you know? And sometimes, as in the previous broadcast I did concerning certification is not qualification, you know that a person can be highly lettered, highly qualified, certified as the case may be in a discipline, and then, you know, when situations present themselves, sometimes they are not able to demonstrate the supposed intelligence that they possess to solve these problems. So there have been a range of definitions. I will just mention a few. You know, it has been defined, you know, in some cases as the ability to adapt and the ability to respond to your environment. And I think that has some merit in the sense that if you know stuff, you should be able to use that stuff to adapt and to shape your environment, shape your circumstances, and to move in a direction that is beneficial to you. But if you know stuff and you cannot adapt, you cannot use it, well then you have to question, where does intelligence come into the picture if you are not able to, you know, adapt yourself and be flexible and adjust accordingly to make things work for you. You also could look at it in from the point of view of being able to judge, being able to reason, being able to comprehend. Now when we talk about judging, I mean judgment is up to God if you look at it in that context. But sometimes we have to make a judgment as to what to do in a given situation. That will cause some level of intelligence that you may not find in a book. It might be intuitive or it may be based on experience that you have to, you know, quickly pull things together and make a judgment call. it may be a question of judging character. Now, full stop, that might be a bit challenging, but sometimes there is something within a lot of us where sometimes you can sense things and feel things and understand things. I guess that would be a reflection of a certain kind of intelligence to guide you in making a proper decision. We need to comprehend a lot of things in life, whether it's within our household, whether it's outside of our household, whether it's in the workplace, whether it's in the exam room. Comprehension is important before you can apply what you know that may give an indication of some level of intelligence, you know. So that is one definition. I mean, it's not full in terms of covering all angles. Another way that's been defined is your ability to solve novel situations. And I think that simple definition is very, very powerful in that you could know a lot of theory, you could know a lot of things, but at the end of the day, when something that you never had to deal with before comes before you, can you rise to the occasion and solve that problem and create a better outcome for others and yourself, the society at large? So that requires a brand of intelligence that only will emerge given your confrontation with that situation. And if someone can rise to the occasion, rise to the fore, and provide solutions, I think if you crown them as being intelligent, that will indeed be a very worthy commendation for them in terms of being able to solve another situation. I remember some time back, a gentleman was sharing a story with me in that there was some major construction in my country here in Trinidad and Tobago, in South Trinidad, in the area we know as the Mosquito Creek. And he said there was a young man catching crab close by in the mangrove, and there was a vehicle that, based on the height of the vehicle, it was a challenge for the vehicle to clear the bridge without touching the top. And all the technical people on site, the civil engineers, the other supervisors, etc., they were challenged in how they would have been able to get this vehicle to pass. And this crab catcher came across and spoke with the person in charge and said that he has an idea. Fortunately, the man was humble and he did give the crab catcher a hearing. The crab catcher told him, all you have to do is inflate the air in the tires and the vehicle will be able to pass. So said, so done. Now this crab catcher, not certified in anything, may be supposedly not considered intelligent, yet he was able to come to the party, albeit uninvited, but you know, being responsive to a situation and providing a solution, demonstrated a level of intelligence that all of the other personnel on site, including all the highly certified or qualified persons, however you want to term them, who were unable to come up with another solution. So that is a very real example of intelligence and display out of a place that most would not have expected it to emerge. So I go back to my opening quotation in the motivational section. Intelligence is not the purview of scholars. We have been blessed with it. It's all up to us to exercise it as situations arise. So, given the few definitions that I presented, you know, psychologists continue to struggle in terms of clearly defining what intelligence really is. And I have added to the discussion, who really has it? I'm saying all of us. All of us, we are intelligent in different ways. It's just a matter of exercising that intelligence as situations arise. So, we have one writer, Schillinger, 2005, who said, given the difficulty in defining intelligence, we can look at it as an assortment of useful behaviors. And I think that is a useful framework that we can use, right? Because you cannot limit intelligence in a corner or just in your ability to deal with one particular situation. It'll go across a whole spectrum of things. At the end of the day, your ability to use that intelligence to solve, to adapt, to create, to make a way that wasn't possible before, to move forward without major encumbrances, all will be a reflection of intelligence. So I just want to remind you, do not label intelligence, do not put intelligence in a box, in a corner, do not place it in a silo, because it is so fluid and so dynamic, hence the reason defining it could be so challenging. Hence the reason Shilingja suggested we can look at it as an assortment of useful behaviors. And I quite, concur with that position, given the fluidity of defining intelligence. We have another psychologist, Sternberg, who spoke about, two concepts. One, he spoke about the G factor, a general factor of intelligence that people possess, and it may cut across a range of areas. Now, that might be debatable. In some cases, it might be perfect in that, a person demonstrating a capacity in one area, it may cut across a range of different areas, but that is not necessarily the case. However, another concept he has in terms of looking at intelligence on the practical side, the creative side, and the analytical side could be particularly useful, because sometimes in a situation, pragmatism is required. That pragmatism may arise out of native intelligence, it may arise out of experience, it may arise out of knowledge, but at the end of the day, given the factors that are at hand, even probably the background to the situation, what is the most practical thing to do will be a clear demonstration of practical intelligence. So this is why I continue to emphasize the point, intelligence can never be the purview of any scholars, because the crab catcher was both practical, he was both creative, right? So being creative in terms of intelligence is coming up with ideas, coming up with solutions that probably no one has thought about, that wasn't considered, that only when it came to the party, only when it came to the fore, that people were able to take a deep breath and say, yes, this is really making sense, and this is something that we can use. So given the period we're living in the world today, during this COVID-19 pandemic, now is a time that really, really requires a lot of creative solutions, all right? And those creative solutions may not necessarily be in the head of any one individual, but collectively, we can put our thoughts together, and out of that, broad base of ideas, I'm sure a lot of creative ideas can emerge. So given the fact that we need to be our brothers keepers and sisters keepers now more than any other time in our existence, I trust that we can tap into that creativity, drawing on the collective genius that the Egyptians spoke about in bringing out a brand of intelligence to make life a little more tolerant, more productive, and in every other way, because life has been constrained tremendously given the pandemic that we are living in. But nonetheless, we got to continue living. We cannot throw our hands in the air and say because of COVID-19, life has ended. Life still continues, and we need to exercise our intelligence to ensure that we live in a productive way. So practical intelligence is what it's sort, creative intelligence, and of course, analytical intelligence. So as we know, when we're analyzing, we picking apart, we pulling together, we fitting, we completing a puzzle, we synthesizing the information and evaluating it too, in terms of giving us ideas and a better understanding of what is at hand. So that triad of intelligence or Sternberg also makes a lot of sense. Practical intelligence, creative intelligence, and analytical intelligence. Another psychologist, Howard Gardner, spoke about multiple intelligences, right? Whether it's on the kinesthetic level, the language level, the mathematical level, the social level, the artistic level, the enterprising level, And if we look at it in that kind of way, there are many persons, they may not probably be in what you consider strong in mathematics or some academic area, but in terms of movement in terms of manipulating their bodies, you know, they definitely will be demonstrating a level of intelligence that sometimes is out of the world. Socially, you know, we have the whole notion now of emotional intelligence, you know, and probably I will do a separate presentation on that on another broadcast. But, you know, the idea of being aware of self, being aware of others, using that knowledge to manage people and to understand situations. And the more you understand yourself, is the better, or your emotional state, I should say, is the better you are able now to manage that situation, and also your sensitivity and understanding your social environment would indicate a knowledge of outside of yourself, socially. So those four principles of emotional intelligence speaks to self-awareness, awareness of your emotions, and management, your ability based on that awareness of your emotions to manage them and to relate to others, your social awareness in terms of people around you and the environment around you, and relationship management, pulling the first three together to manage people in a more effective manner. Now, the research has shown that people high in emotional intelligence are more successful in life than those who are just probably with a high IQ. So when we look at IQ, and then people talk about highly intelligent people with a high IQ, IQ is very limited in terms of a true measure of intelligence, because it just measures intelligence in a few domains, you know, in terms of language capacity, mathematical performance, and spatial, you know. Those four domains are not enough to give a real true sense of the intelligence of a person. Hence the reason, you know, if a person is trying to enter a university, a wise university will not only use an IQ score, but they will look at recommendations, they will look at a lot of other things, attributes of the person, in terms of making an assessment whether this person is a fit person for entering a particular university. Another thing about the IQ test, they are culturally sometimes biased, so that sometimes they were designed in a particular part of the world, and if you use them in another part of the world, that reflection of that score may not be a true indication of what really, of the true intelligent capacity of that person, given that cultural bias, and then the language in which the questions are phrased, and obviously the answers may not be as expected because of that particular bias, all right? So the area of intelligence is intriguing, is interesting, and although I have referenced a few definitions, I am quite sure you could appreciate and recognize that it is not an easy thing to define. Nonetheless, when native intelligence emerges, we can all easily identify it. As one YouTuber said, a yogi Sadhguru, that sometimes people confuse a person who knows a lot of stuff, who has a lot of information, with the application of intelligence. So when you are confronted with something that you were never confronted with before, it's not just a question of about drawing an information, but a question of applying that intelligence to deal with the situation. So we need to clearly make that distinction. We need to clearly understand that we need to carefully categorize how and who we are considering to be intelligent. So my argument, do not only consider people who are academically qualified as intelligent, because that is always a debate and an interesting debate, because that may not necessarily be the case given certain things they are confronted with and the ability to provide solutions. So there has been an argument, at least throughout my lifetime, or at least at the earlier part in my life, where you will have heard people, and you still hear it being said, that, you know, if a person is not too intelligent or not too bright, well, they must not worry with the academic stream, they must go into a trade. Now that is an amazing kind of argument to me that doesn't make much sense, because if you are going into a trade, doesn't mean that you should lack intelligence. Doesn't mean that if you are an electrician, a carpenter, a plumber, a mason, being in those professions, does that mean that you lack intelligence? In other words, if you are employing someone to work in your home, will you be employing someone who lacks intelligence? So the intelligence of the carpenter, of the mason, of the plumber, of the mechanic, of the electrician, that intelligence is no less than the intelligence of the university professor or the medical doctor. They are all intelligent in different domains. All right? For example, some people will say that, you know, a person in sport lacks intelligence. But at the end of the day, to be an effective and potent sports person, the key to that, besides the actual capacity to play the sport, is intelligence. We have a lot of challenges with our West Indies cricket team, and a lot of the challenges, you know, to observant eyes, is not a lack of the actual talent to play the game, but the mental attitude, the ability to think through situations, the ability to concentrate for long periods. So the superior team, the superior athletes, they are not only physically fit, they are mentally strong and they are mentally acute. And those who can apply their intelligence in a race situation, in a game situation, those are the ones who will emerge on top of the field, as the recent Olympics has clearly shown. So my argument to you again, you know, is someone who involved in hockey, basketball, football, cricket, swimming, netball, horse racing, golf, are those individuals less intelligent than the engineer, than the lawyer, or the doctor? If you believe so, my humble advice to you, I humbly ask you to recognize that that is a huge error you are making. Intelligence cuts across a range of areas, and no matter what the area we are speaking about, intelligence is critical, and the application of that intelligence for success. So whether it's sport, whether it's culture, whether it's medicine, whether it's law, whether it's plumbing, carpentry, or masonry, you name it, intelligence is a central. So if we look at that G factor that Spearman spoke about, that general factor of intelligence, it is not limited just to a particular discipline. Just as he said that they will perform in a range of areas, it may not necessarily mean that they will perform in a range of areas, but they may have that G factor that will allow them at least to perform in an area they are good at or in a number of other areas. So I strongly make the point, let us look at intelligence in a much more fluid way. Let us be open-minded, let us be receptive, and let us understand that when intelligence is on display, do not look for a title to acclaim it. Once it comes to the party, once it is demonstrated, let us acknowledge it and let us recognize that any one of us, all of us, have been sufficiently blessed with God-given intelligence. It's just a question of exercising it to the best of our abilities to make our lives better, to make the lives of our communities better, to make the lives of society at large, to make the lives of people in the world, and to solve situations where humanity could have a much better experience. So today, topic of intelligence is for your consideration. I know you will have received the message loud and clear. You will think about it differently. You will be more respectful to a range of persons, because intelligence is not the purview of only scholars. So let us respect the sportsmen. Let us respect the singers. Let us respect the dancers. Let us respect the cricketers. Let us respect the mechanics, the plumbers, of course, the engineers, the lawyers. But do not only believe that only those types of individuals are the ones who are intelligent. So once the message resonated with you, as usual, we ask you to subscribe to the channel. We ask you to like the videos, comment on them, share them, and most importantly, turn on the bell notification when you have subscribed, so that any video that is posted, you will be able to get the notification. We also remind you that as a life coach and consultant, we are open for you to book appointments, to have one-on-one sessions or workshops. So call us at 1-868-778-5141, 1-868-779-2544, or email us at leadershipwithadifference@gmail.com. So let us acclaim those, all of those who are intelligent, and let us create a better world for one of us. So thank you again for listening, and stay tuned for another episode next week, Monday. And in the meantime, between time, continue viewing the videos and sharing and liking them. Thank you very much, and bye.